Welcome everyone. Happy to see everyone. A family reunion. So today is Tu Beshevat. We begin with making the brachot on the perot. First is the mezonot. Then wine. Of the fruits, we begin with the olives. This is for all of the fruits. The wine is also good for the beer. L'chaim. Tu Beshevat is the new year of the trees, especially of Etz Chaim, the tree of life. A few days ago was Yud Shvat. The custom is to write a pan to the Rebbe, that you begin the pan by saying, may we be connected or cling to the tree of life. Because Yud Shvat is samuch to Tu Beshevat, to today.
apple.
The tree of life, there are roots. The roots are the souls of the tzaddikim that reveal to us the pnimius ha-tero. Then there's the trunk of the tree, the geza, which is the Torah itself that they reveal to the world. Then there are the branches, which are the chsidim, or all that are connected, all souls that are connected to the tzaddikim through the trunk of the Torah that they teach and that they reveal. And finally, the purpose is the fruit, which is the good deeds and bringing the light of Hashem to the world. So we should merit to be branches that bear sweet fruit. There are seven fruits of Eretz Yisrael. The praise, the shevach of Eretz Yisrael. Many of them Chazal consider to be possible candidates for what was the primordial tree of knowledge that Adam and Eve ate of. The forbidden fruit, and because of that, the decree of the opposite of death came, the opposite of life, death came to the world. So many of these fruits are once more possibilities of different opinions in Chazal of these ages. What was the tree of knowledge? And one says that it was grapes, or one even says that it was wheat. And so forth. According to the pshat of Rashi, it's the figs, because afterwards the figs, the leaves of the figs were used to clothe Adam and Eve. But all of them have a root, an inner root in the tree of life. So that's what we're going to talk about. That all of these fruits were now in the Eretz Yisrael, Eretz HaChaim. It's a land of life. And all of the fruits have to do with the tree of life, or ultimately are rooted in the tree of life. There's a very beautiful phenomenon that I don't believe that we ever spoke about in relation to the seven species, that the phrase tree of life appears seven times in the Tanakh, in the Bible. So that's a very clear allusion that the tree of life has seven aspects or seven manifestations, which are the origin of the seven fruits of Eretz Yisrael. In the beginning of creation, so there were two trees in the Garden of Eden, the tree of life and the tree of knowledge. It says, "V'etz ha'chaim mitoch hagan v'etz ha'dat tovura." It says that the tree of life was situated in the very middle point of the garden, and as well was the tree of knowledge of good and evil. But once more, the verse reads, "V'etz ha'chaim mitoch hagan." It's the tochiyut. The inner essence of the garden was the tree of life. And then it's repeated another two times in the story. But after Adam and Eve ate from the forbidden fruit, so Hashem has to expel them from the Garden of Eden, and the justification for expelling them, shall I not take it down? The justification that the Torah states for expelling them from the Garden of Eden is lest they send their hand and partake of the forbidden group of the Eitz HaChaim. That they take from the tree of life and they eat from it, and they will live forever. And that living forever is in this context already negative. It means that they will forever be blemished. They will never come to their true tikkun, the true rectification, which is through the cycle that we're going to also speak about of yurida tzorech aliyah, of descent for the sake of ascent. The descent is actually the opposite of life. The death itself is a part of the rectification of the soul. And if they would live forever now in their blemished state of being, that would not be good. So Hashem says that God says that that we have to once more expel them from the garden, lest they send their hand and take from the tree of life and eat and live forever. So that's the second time. Lakach me etz ha-chayim. That the phrase etz ha-chayim, tree of life, is mentioned. And at the very end, the next verse reads that Hashem did expel them from the Garden of Eden, and he placed their kruvim ve'lat ha'cherev ha'mitapechet lishmor et derech etz ha'chaim. He placed several barriers to guard them from not being able to enter the way, to get to the way of the tree of life, to prevent Adam and Eve from approaching the tree of life. So there are three times that the tree of life is mentioned. Once before the sin, and twice after the sin. Ve'etz ha'chaim b'toch ha'gan, v'lakach me'etz ha'chaim v'achal v'chay l'olam, lishmor et derech etz ha'chaim. Okay, so three times. Each time it's the phrase is etz ha'chaim, the tree of life, with the word life preceded by a hey ayidia, the tree of life. But then the phrase repeats itself just in one other book in the Bible, which is Mishlei, the book of Proverbs, which is called Sefer HaChokhmah, the book of wisdom, also written by the wisest of all men, who was King Solomon. And there the phrase is always Etz Chaim, not Etz HaChaim, but Tree of Life, not the Tree of Life, but just the phrase is Tree of Life, Etz Chaim. And there are four different verses in Proverbs and Mishlei that this idiom, this phrase appears. So since these are less known and very significant for us, I want to look one by one. Actually, the seven species of Eretz Yisrael are also divided, according to Kabbalah, into three and four. I would expect that, according to the Sfirot, the three would be Chagat, Chesed, Gevurah, Tiferet, and four would then be Netzach, Hod, Yisod, Malchut. The Arizal surprises us and says that the three are Chabad, the first three. The first three of the species, which are Chitan, Soran, Geffen, but wheat, barley, and grapes are Chabad. And the four that follow, which are the figs and the pomegranates and the olives and the dates, are the last four Sfirot. And so leaving a vacuum in between of the Chagat. Exactly the same model, the same division is in this phenomenon of the Eitz HaChaim, that there are three Eitz HaChaim in the story of creation, in Breshit, in Genesis. And then there are another four in a different book altogether. And it's once more, the phraseology is slightly different. Instead of Et HaChaim, it's Etz Chaim each time. The first of the four is a well-known verse in Mishlei that we say often. It's Etz Chaim Lamachazikim Ba V'Tomche HaMurusha. It's referring to the Torah. And it says that the Torah is a tree of life for those that take hold of it, and those that support it are happy. Very important, pertinent verse to all of us. That's towards the beginning of Proverbs. It's in the third chapter. It's Proverbs 3:18. It's the 73rd verse from the beginning of Proverbs. 73 is Chokmah, wisdom. And much more, it reads, Eitz Chaim Hila Machazikim Ba V'Tomchem Urusha, implying that you have to take hold of it strong in order for the Torah to be your tree of life. You have to take hold. Even the commentaries make a point of explaining that the word machazikim is the key word in this verse. So we have to take hold strong of the Torah, and then it is for us a tree of life, and those that support it are happy. If these four from Mishlei correspond to the four final sfirot, which are the sfirot of action, then this one corresponds to Netzach, to victory and to eternity. Netzach means both victory and eternity. And it goes very well with the chidush. Once more, the commentary says that the chidush of this verse is the word machazikim, to take hold strong of it. O chazim. And that in the soul to be strong in something is a netzach property, a netzach attribute. And also tomchea, it says explicitly in Kabbalah that the support is also the netzach of the legs, that they support the body. So both the concept of machazikim as well as tomcheha very well relate to netzach. So much more. This verse we probably recognize. The next one, it's in chapter 11 in Proverbs. It's 11:30. And this is perhaps the most important for us, for Tu Beshevat. Because it also is Etz Chaim, the tree of life, and it also is pre. It has the word pre, fruit in it. It's a tree and fruit. And the verse reads, Pre Tzadik Etz Chaim. The fruit of the tzaddik is the tree of life. And then the end, the continuation of the verse is the most interesting. It says, V'lokeach nefashot chacham. And he that takes souls is wise. So we have to understand what that means and what the context is, what the relation is. Pre-tzaddik is the fruit of the tzaddik is the good deeds of the tzaddik. So the good deeds of the tzaddik itself becomes a tree of life for everyone that learns. The way the commentaries explain it. The fruits of the tzaddik become, I would think that the fruits are on the tree. But the verse reads, Pri tzaddik etz chayim, means that the fruits of the tzaddik become a tree of life for everyone that is closer, that learns, that observes even the tzaddik. The commentaries say that in this verse there are two people that are mentioned here. One is called the tzaddik, the righteous soul, and the other is called the chacham, the wise man. What's the difference between a tzaddik and a wise man? So both are for the sake of teaching us the way of life, how to live properly. The tzaddik teaches us how to live through his deeds, through his example. I look at him and I see how he acts in life, and that's the way he teaches me the path of life, the derech hachayim. The chacham, a wise man, throughout Mishlei, whenever it uses the concept of wise man, it's always a teaching through his words. It's a very interesting differentiation. There's a person who teaches through his deeds, not through his words. There's a person who teaches through his words. And that's why very often in Mishlei there's this juxtaposition of tzaddik versus chacham. So this is one of them. That the pre-tzaddik, the fruit of the tzaddik, is the tree of life. And he that takes souls, what does it mean to take souls? He that takes souls is wise. So first of all, Rashi, even the Chumash, says that when you take people, like human beings, that are very often in the Bible, there's taking people. Taking people is always with words. It's one of the proofs, actually, that the wise man, his influence on society is through his words. And by his words, he takes souls. What does it mean that he takes souls? Even as it says that there are three possible interpretations, that each one of them is, I mean, they go together. You can have actually all three together, but three different ways of understanding what it means to take souls. One is that you teach souls. Yichnemem in Yiddish. If you say words that penetrate deeply into the heart of someone else. So that's called taking the beauty. I take you with my words. It's a very beautiful image. Both in Hebrew and this, and in Yiddish also the same idiom. Ich nehm dir, I take you. So a wise man is a person that takes souls. So once more, even though it says that the first interpretation of taking souls is through just his teaching, machkim, he makes them with his wisdom, he makes them wise, and he takes them with his words. The second is to take also means to purchase, to buy in the Torah law. Lokech mekach, mekach umimkar. So Avraham Avinu, the first Jew, it says that anevesh asher asu becharan, that it doesn't use the word to take, it uses the word to make. They made souls in Haran, where they lived before they came to Israel. What does it mean that they made souls? They purchased servants, slaves. But those slaves became part of their household. And to be part of the household of Avraham Avinu was a very tremendous merit. Because they became converts to the faith, to the true faith of Avraham Avinu. So a second possibility of take souls actually to purchase. What could that mean in modern society, that there's no You don't, nowadays we don't buy slaves. It means that you employ them. That a wise man knows how to employ people. And by employment, you say have a big company, a big corporation. And all of your hundreds of workers, ashrecha kama, happy is their fate that they're working for you, and that your company and your corporation, you're teaching them Torah. Once more, either because you're a tzaddik, as we said, that a tzaddik teaches by his example, by the way that he acts and behaves, or that if you're a chacham, you teach them with your words. That's possibility number two, what it means to take souls, according to the Ibn Ezra. Possibility number three, what it means to take souls. I take souls in the four phrases, the four idioms of Gula, of redemption from Egypt. It's Bohotzeti, I took them out of Egypt. Vitzalti, I saved them from bondage. Vigaalti, I redeemed them. Bilaka, I took them. Taking someone is actually the highest form of saving or redeeming him. It's even above the word gula. It means I redeem him from where he was. A wise man, once more through his words, he takes, as though I'm taking him out of hell. He takes souls, he elevates souls. It has to do with the concept that we're going to talk about, which is Yiridat Zorach Aliyah, descent for the sake of ascent. So once more, this is all pshat of the Ibn Ezra, a very beautiful pshat, three meanings of what it means to take souls. And each one of everyone here is, we're all supposed to be teachers. Should also be tzaddikin, that we set a good example, that people should be able to look at us and see how a Jew should act and live his life. But also we should be chachamim, wise people, that we teach with our words. And by teaching with our words, we take souls. And this all comes out of this phrase, pri tzaddik etz chayim, that the fruit of the tzaddik is the tree of life. And the wise man, who is the friend, the companion here of the tzaddik, of the righteous man, he takes souls. Meaning once more, three things. It means that he teaches them wisdom, and he takes them with his words. It means that they become inspired, and they become, you can say in English, he turns them on. A wise man knows how to turn on people with his words. That's number one meaning of to take them. And the second meaning of to take them is actually he employs them. He makes them part of his company, part of his corporation. And the third meaning of taking them is that he redeems them, that he elevates them, he saves them. So this is once more a very beautiful verse. We like also doing a gematriot. We have the seven fruits of Eretz Yisrael. We have these seven times in the Tanakh that the tree of life appears. But there's something about this phrase pri tzaddik which alludes to another fruit which is here on the table. How much does pri tzaddik equal? This is one of our famous old-time gematriot. Pri tzaddik, the fruit of the tzaddik. There's one fruit that is called in the Bible the fruit of the righteous man, pri tzaddik. There's even we might recognize this phrase pri tzaddik because it's a sefer. It's a very important Hasidic sefer, Reb Sodok HaKohen, pri tzaddik. Pri is 290 and tzaddik is 204. So together it's how much? $4.94. What fruit on the table equals $4.94? Which is, for some mysterious reason that we also talked about many, many times, people think that that's the tree of
Tapuach.
Exactly. Apple, Tapuach, equals Pri Tzadik. There's something about an apple which is the fruit of the tzaddik. There's a lot in Chassidus about the apple and the apple tree. The apple tree is a very special tree. In the Song of Songs, the love song between the divine groom and bride. Which now, again, we've had many classes and talk about the apple. But that the apple is the Pri Tzadik. Etz Chaim, how much is it? Etz HaChaim, in the Torah it's Etz HaChaim, which is 233, but in the Mishlei here four times, it's Etz Chaim, which is 228. What's the common denominator, or the common divisor of 494? And 228. The Pri Tzadik is 494, which is Tapuach, but it's also a multiple of Hashem's name of 26. Very important number. 26, 494 divided by 26 is how much? It's 19. 26 is Yutke Vavke, the four-letter name, and the 19 is the filling of Shem Ma. Ma equals Adam, and the filling of the letters equals Chava. 19. What about 228, which is Etz Chaim? It's 12 times 19. So there's a common denominator here, which is 12 times, which is 19, and the average value of the two phrases, Pri Tzadik, Etz Chaim, is actually 19 squared. So the number that is emphasized here in this phrase is Chava. Something about the Pri Tzadik, Etz Chaim, which alludes to Eve, the tikkun of Eve, or the first woman, the Eim Kochai, the mother of all life. She herself is the Pri Tzadik. Etz Chaim. There are another few allusions. Just the initial letters of Pri Tzadik Etz Chaim. Pei Tzadik Ayin Chet. How much does that equal? 80, 90, 78. Pri Tzadik Etz Chaim. Moshe. Machan equals Abraham. So Abraham is also here. Together the whole phrase is 722, which is 2 times 19 squared. So what are the other letters? How much do they equal? Take 722 minus 248. You get
God.
But in our context, Tu Beshevat, today is the holiday of the trees, and we say this is a lot of Hasidut, especially the Rebbe always quotes that who is the tree? What does that symbolize? Symbolizes man. How do I know that man is the symbol of man is a tree? Because Adam et hasadeh. Is the tree of the field. And the tree of the field equals Dat. So actually in this phrase, Pri Tzadik Etz Chaim, we have both Abraham, the first consummate man, which is the first man that believes in God fully and teaches that belief to the whole world, which is Abraham. And that corresponds with his name equals 248, which are the 248 limbs of man. And he is called Ha'adam HaGadol Ba'anakim, he is referred to as man. And then the other letters equal, remaining letters equal the tree of the field, which is the symbol in the Torah for man. Which equals Dat, because man has knowledge. Knowledge of God. So this was all this very beautiful verse, Proverbs 11:30, Pri tzadik etz chayim velokeach nefashot chacham. I think everybody here takes souls. So we should all be successful. First, once more, first to be the example of the Pri tzadik, and to take a lot, all of the souls, to be very wise to take souls. Right, the next one, is chapter 13. Chapter 13, verse 12. Tochelet memushacha machala lev ve'etz chayim ta'ava ba'a. The prolonged anticipation. If I'm waiting for something to happen and it doesn't happen, I expect it, I'm expecting something to happen, and it's taking too long. We can already imagine what that might refer to. It's called tochelet memushacha, a expectation, anticipation that is prolonged, too prolonged. Machala lev, that causes heart failure. It's the illness of the heart. Ve'etz chayim, but, the verse says, the tree of life is when ta'ava ba'a, when your desire comes. Means becomes. Once more. Tochelet memushacha, prolonged anticipation, is heart disease. Ve'etz chayim, but the tree of life is when your desire comes. One of the commentaries here, the Malbim, so he says that there are three words that are used together in different verses in Proverbs that are similar, but we have to distinguish between the three terms. One is tochelet, which means when I'm very strongly waiting for something to happen. And once more, expecting it to happen, anticipating it to happen. The second is tikva, hope. And the third is ta'ava, desire. And there, once more, these three words are used closely, almost as synonyms, but they're different in various verses in Proverbs. What's the difference between the three? The difference between the three is how sure you are that it's going to happen. If you're very sure that it must happen, it's going to happen, then it's called tochelet. If you're not 100% sure that it's going to happen, but you're hoping, then it's called hope, that I hope it's going to happen. That's tikva. And if I really don't know at all if it's really going to happen or not, but I would like it to happen, then it's called ta'ava, or desire or passion. It means ta'ava is something that I would really like for it to happen. I have a ta'ava, but whether it's going to really happen or not, I don't know. But more than that is tikva, which is hope. And more than that is tochelet. Tochelet is something that I'm sure it's going to happen. So from this he explains how to read properly this verse. There's something, a tochelet, that I'm sure it's going to happen, and it doesn't happen. So that hits the heart. That harms, causes disease of the heart. Machalalev. But Etz Chaim, the tree of life, means that there's a fruit, the tree of life, which is just one's desire actually comes true. Ta'avaba. So you don't even have to once more be sure that something is just. The tree of life is that just whatever I desire happens. It says about tzaddikim once more, another one of the verses here in Proverbs reads, ta'avat tzaddikim achtov. Usually the word ta'avah is used in a negative context, passions. But there are several verses in the Bible that is used in a positive context. It says, ta'avat tzaddikim achtov, the passion, the desire of a tzaddik is purely good. It's good. He only has good passions. Another verse reads, ta'avat tzaddikim yiten, that God gives the tzaddik his passions. Much more a passion, there's no real reason why it's going to happen. But when it does happen, that's Etz Chaim. So actually, if these verses follow the order of the fruits, we say the fruits of the origin of the fruits, which may refer to the Etz Hadat, the tree of knowledge, but their ultimate origin in the tree of life. So this is already, what number is this? This is number 6, right? So that's already the Aleph, which is actually the first one that you bless on. Make the blessing of the fruits. It's after the wheat. But of the actual fruits of the tree, the first one is the Aleph. That's Yesod. The Yesod has to do with Tava, has to do with Tochelet. The last one is here also in chapter 15. Verse 4. It reads, Marpe Lashon Etz Chaim. Veselef ba Shever Beruach. A healing tongue is the tree of life. The perversion of it, selef is perversion. The perversion of the tongue is the breaking of the spirit. Mapei Lashon Etz Chaim. V'selef ba shever beruach. So it's saying that the tree of life, what's more, the tree of life we said before means that something becomes a tree of life for people. What is a tree of life for society? A healing tongue. When you speak healing words, that is a tree of life for everyone that you address. Marpei Lashon Etz Chaim. Beselef ba, commentators explain that to speak healing words also means to always be honest and speak the truth. You might think that healing words is not always the truth. You're just trying to make somebody happy, so you say what you think is going to make him happy. But the commentator explained that a healing tongue is healing through the truth. It's a very interesting observation in itself. It's healing with truth. So what does it mean, perversion, the opposite? Beselef ba means that you speak hypocrisy. Beselef ba sheva beruah, that breaks the spirit of man. Nothing that breaks spirit as hypocrisy or as perversion of truth, which is the perversion of healing. If I encourage someone, so once more I might think that I'm just encouraging him not necessarily because it's the absolute truth that I think, that I believe. But that's not so. Rabbi Nachman used to say that the very worst thing is despair. And he said despair is a lie. It's false. The truth is always optimistic. That's one of the foundations of Rabbi Nachman throughout the Hasidut. The truth and optimism goes together. Neither the opposite of truth, which is a lie, and pessimism goes together. Pessimism is a lie. That's expressed here in this verse. Marpei Lashon Etz Chaim, the tree of life, is the healing tongue. And the perversion of that, Beselef ba sheva beruah, that breaks the spirit. So now we went through all these four verses from Proverbs, which are complete the seven verses in the Torah, in the Bible, the whole Tanakh, of Etz Chaim, which we're now saying we may see correspond to the seven fruits of the Eretz Yisrael, which is also divided into three and four. We'll conclude this simply with a very amazing yamatzia, that the initial phrase, which is before the sin, because we want to get to the tree of life. Tu Beshevat, this holiday of Tu Beshevat is returning, even though Hashem put the angels and the sword in the way of lishmarat erech etz ha'chaim, that we shouldn't be able to approach and enter the Garden of Eden and eat the tree of fruit, the tree of life. But through the Torah, and especially through the Pnimiuta Torah, the inner dimension of the Torah, we do believe that we're going to techav miad mamash, reach the tree of life and eat from the tree of life. That's Mashiach and the Torah that he will teach us. So we want the tree of life. So we want to return to that pristine primordial state of Ve'etza Chaim B'toch Hagan Ve'etza Da'at Tovara, that it's all good. But the first verse is before the sin. All the others are after. That first verse, once more it reads, Ve'etza Chaim B'toch Hagan Ve'etza Da'at Tovara, that the tree of life is in the midst of the, it's the middle point. We speak and learn a lot about the meaning of the middle point. He said that there's an allusion here to Chava, to Eve. Eve is called the middle point of man. The woman is the middle point. So it says that the Eitz HaChaim is the midst, in the midst of the garden, together with the Eitz HaDaat, Tov V'Ra. That whole phrase, you calculate its gematria, the number is 1663. If I would add one to it, which is called the Kolel, I would get two times the Eretz Yisrael, 64 times Havaya. So at first glance, that's what I thought maybe is the significance of this number. But it's a second observation, the Torah is exact. It doesn't need for me to add the Kolel. Because that number, 1663, afterwards, if I add together all of the seven times that the phrase appears throughout the Tanakh, exactly the way it's written in the Tanakh, in the Bible, once the first one is Ve'etz HaChaim, the second one is Me'etz HaChaim, the third is Etz HaChaim, and then in Mishlei there's Etz Chaim, Etz Chaim, Ve'etz Chaim, Etz Chaim. Exactly the way it's written, all of those seven times equals exactly 1663. Which means it's all contained within the first phrase, which is the state of before the sin. The way Hashem created the Chatchila, he created the world, he created the Garden of Eden, and Ve'etza Chaim B'toch Hagan Ve'etza Da'at Tov V'Ra. So this was topic number one, the Chaim L'Chaim. Remember these verses and to contemplate these verses, that's a hitbonanot, that's a meditation. It's a Tu Beshevat meditation. Beer is barley, so You want to say something?
No.
Someone should have an aliyat and shaman. You should be merit to see him with us here.
To deal with us again.
No, to see him here together with us.
Google again.
The second little meditation that we're going to do now has to do with Parashat HaShavua. There's a mitzvah to connect things to Parashat HaShavua. And Tu Beshevat, like this year, is in Parashat Yitro, which is Matan Torah, the giving of the Torah. That is certainly very, very significant, that the Eitz HaChaim is the Torah, and especially the Pnimiyut HaTorah, Nishmet HaDorah, is referred to as Eitz HaChaim. It says, "Vayered Hashem al Har Sinai." Hashem descended. God descended on Mount Sinai to give us the Torah. For several months now, we've been talking about the concept in Hasidut of Yirida Tzorech Aliyah. Descent is for the sake of ascent. So one of the basic sources, origins of this concept of descent and ascent is in this context of of the giving of Torah, of God descending, and we, through our messenger, which is Moshe Rabbeinu ascending, God descends to us and we ascend to God. There's a famous midrash that the Rebbe always quotes, that at the beginning of creation, Hashem decreed that the higher worlds should not ascend to the lower worlds, and the lower worlds should not ascend to the higher worlds. But when it came the time to give the Torah to Am Yisrael, he nullified and annulled that decree. And now the higher worlds will ascend to the lower worlds, and the lower worlds to the higher worlds. The idiom that Chazal used is the B'nai Romi and B'nai Surya, that they're the inhabitants or citizens of Rome and the citizens of Syria. And the citizens of Rome, the B'nai Romi, are called the higher worlds for some reason, but we'll explain why. And the citizens of Syria, are called the lower worlds. And the king of kings, he decreed that the B'nai Romi lo yardu the Syria. The children of Surah should not ascend to Rome. And the Medrash says, but at one point he annulled that decree, and now the B'nai Romi can descend to Surah, and the B'nai Surah can ascend to Rome. Why is Romi the higher worlds? Because the word Romi means exalted, high. And why is Surah the lower worlds? It says because Surya means lasur min aderech, to stray away from the path, from the given path. I mean that the lower world is the world of the state of being that people stray away from the truth and from the good. It's called B'nai Surya. So the B'nai Romi that are exalted and they're okay, they don't have anything to do with the B'nai Surya. And the B'nai Surya have no right to ascend and to be together, be part of the B'nai Romi. But the Torah was given in order to nullify that. So actually there's one source that quotes something that's not in the Medrash. We don't have it in our Medrash. But in certain Svarim, after the Medrash written, quote another a sentence, that at a certain point, the king who lives in Rome, the emperor of Rome, he falls in love with a guru from Syria. So there's nothing to do. So because he fell in love with this guru from Syria and he wants to marry her, so for that reason he has to nullify the decree, the initial decree. And that's what happened. That's the giving of the Torah. That's this week's parasha, which is the parasha of Tu Beshevat. That the king who made the decree, he falls in love with the girl from the place that you're not supposed to go to, that place, which is the place of straying away. And that's why the decree was nullified. Now in the Medrash it says that there's a phrase that reads for Aniya Matchil. If the decree was that the higher should not ascend to the lower, the lower should not ascend to the higher, but now that decree is being nullified with the Torah, and I am going to start. Meaning that the king himself says, I'm going to be the first, but I'm going to descend. And when that I am going to descend, that's the phrase. Vayered Hashem al Har Sinai, that Hashem descended on Mount Sinai to give the Torah. Then where does it say the ascent? At the end of Parashat Mishpatim, it says, Vil Moshe Amart, God said to Moses, Alei El Hashem, ascend to God. Now, according to the order of the Torah, it's clear that the verse of Vayered Hashem Har Sinai in Yitro, and at the end of Mishpatim, Further on, the Torah says that God said to Moses, "Ale el Hashem, ascend." But if you look there at Rashi, Rashi says that even though it's written in the Torah afterwards, but it happened before. It happened on the fourth day of Sivan, 2 days before the giving of the Torah. God said to Moses, "Ascend." En mukdam u'mu'achar b'Torah. There's no first and after, or prior and after in the Torah. I mean, the things can be written in the Torah, but they actually took place before. And this is an example according to Rashi, according to Chazal. So how can Chazal say, "Vandia matchilta"? I am the beginner. First, Moses, actually in Parashat Yitro itself, there's another verse that says, "Moshe Allah Ela Elokim," which is before Vayedud Hashem al Har Sinai. Says Moses ascended to Elokim. And even the verse that the Medrash quotes, that Hashem said, "Go up to Hashem," that's also, according to Rashi, happened before. So how can it be that I am the beginner of Aniyah Matchil? So one of the commentaries on the Midrash actually asks, he asked the question, the Marzu, one of the most important commentaries on the Midrash. He says that maybe it's just because of the order, the way it's written in the Torah, and there's another possibility. At the end he says, Sarichiyu. Because he doesn't know the Teirutz, the Taretz, Vaaniyah Matchil. There's something very mysterious, we'll say, about this phrase Vaaniyah Matchil, even the pshat, what it means, I am going to start. It's first Hashem is going to start. One interpretation of Hasidus is that there's always an Isurusa today, even before the Isurusa Tat, even though it doesn't appear explicitly. There's always an arousal from above in order to arouse the from below, and if Moshe Rabbeinu goes up, that's also because Hashem came down to him. But it's not that verse, Vayedud Hashem al Har Sinai. So again, it's still not clear. The Chorah, the Teirutz is, and I haven't yet seen anyone that says it, but someone must say it, that according to many of the Pashtanim, which are the Ibn Ezra first, and then the Rashbam, and then the Ramban, they all say that the Pshat is not like Rashi. That the Pshat of Ve'ela El Moshe Amar Alei El Hashem in the end of Parashat Mishpatim really happened after the giving of the Torah. Right, so this is a whole topic that we can't enter into too much, but the Ramban, who explains at length that his opinion is that the end of Mishpatim is after Matan Torah, the Chorah, this other Midrash of Aniyah Matchil, that's a Ra'aya, that's a proof to his opinion. And the Or HaChaim HaKadosh also says that the Pshat is like these three Rishonim, not like Rashi. Ibn Ezra and the Rashabam and the Ramban, that all agree that Ve'el Moshe Amar Adei El Hashem, that whole parasha at the end of Mishpatim, actually was after the giving of the Torah. So this I also said as a parenthetical concept, that in this week's parasha we have this Yesod, that Hashem nullified the decree, and he began, why am I making a point of this? In order to say that the Yiridah Tzorech Aliyah, if the Aliyah would have been first, then it would have been the opposite principle. There's an opposite principle, which is called Aliyah Tzorech Yiridah. There's something that is sent for the sake of descent. Once more, what happened at the giving of the Torah could be read and seen as it's an ascent for the sake of descent. First an ascent, then a descent. But according to Chazal, Vaaniya Matchil, it's descent for the sake of ascent. Very often we explain that descent for the sake of ascent is a masculine principle, and ascent for the sake of descent is a feminine principle. And actually, when there's a marriage, they go together. The descent becomes the ascent for the sake of descent. This, I'm just saying, by the way, what's the now the what we want to discuss it in short, because it's a big topic. The first medrash that was composed by Chazal is called Pirkei de Rabbi Eliezer. Afterwards, there's Medrash Rabbah. There's a lot of Medrashim, you know, Medrash. The original Medrash of Chazal is called Pirkei de Rabbi Eliezer. It's a whole big book, and it has a very important commentary written by Reb David Luria, which is actually the only text that has a Haskoma of the Tzemach Tzedek to it. The whole Pirkei de Rabbi Eliezer is based on a phrase. It's a big thing. It's based on what's called Eser Yiridot, that there are 10 descents. So this topic of 10 descents is a very big part of our meditation of descent for the sake of ascent. Not in each case is it explicit that the descent is for the sake of ascent. It's just that Hashem, what does it mean, 10 descents? That Hashem, God, descended into his world 10 times. The last time that he's going to descend into his world is when Mashiach comes. He will descend and he will stand, as it were, symbolically, with his legs on the Mount of Olives. And then will be the war of Gog and Magog, and then will be Tchiyat HaMetim. That's the last, the 10th of the 10 descents of the Shekhinah, of the Divine Presence of God into his world. Very, very mind-blowing idea. That God creates the world, he continuously creates the world every second. He's here, he's Mashkiach. He has providence on everything. But so that 10 times he came down into the world. Now obviously every time that he came down into the world, that was in order to springboard something that's going to ascend, because of the, like in physics, for every action there's an equal and opposite reaction. And if infinite energy, which is God, descends into reality, so that's obviously going to make something happen in reality, to rectify reality, which is the ascent of reality. When is the first time that God descended into the world? That's the topic of Yud Shvat. That's the Maimer of the Friedrich Rebbe that we learn every year. Bati Lagani Achoti Kala. I have come down into my garden. The first of the 10 descents is that God descended into the Garden of Eden. The Shekhinah descended into the Garden of Eden. There are two verses that are quoted in the Midrash. One verse is the verse that is the beginning, that is also quoted in Bati Degani, at the beginning of the Maimer, of the discourse. He quotes, Vayishmu et kol Hashem Elokim mithalech bagan ruach hayom, that Adam and Eve heard the voice of God walking through the garden. The voice of God walking through the garden. When was that? That's after the sin. Then God came down to speak with them. Well, what did you do? He actually gave Adam the opportunity to confess. Had he confessed, everything would have been rectified. But he didn't confess. So that's called, from that verb, mitalech. Mitalech is the reflexive form of going, of walking. It's walking back and forth. So how do the Chazal interpret that word, mitalech? Kafitz v'ole. Jumping up, little by little. So how is it explained in the Midrash and the Maimar of Bose Degani? That actually, because of the sin, the Shekhinah that previously had been here below, in this world, was jumping up and actually leaving the world. But in the other Midrash, it says the very opposite. It says, mitalech, from that word mitalech, I learned that the Shekhinah descended into this world. From the Ma'amar of Bati Legani, and that word that God, they heard the voice of God walking back and forth. Mitalech bagam ruach hayom. That means kafitz v'ole, kafitz v'sadi, kafitz v'sadi. It was skipping and jumping up little by little, leaving the garden because of the sin. But he didn't leave until he conversed with Adam and Eve, and actually had to decree their punishment. But according to the other Midrash, that verse and that phrase, mitalech began, that's saying that God is now descending into the, after the sin, he's descending into the garden. He's coming down into the world in order to elevate the world, not to elevate himself. It's two opposite interpretations of what that word mitalech began the ruach hayom implies. But since that word mitalech can be interpreted the opposite way, the midrash of the, was called the Eser Yeridot, of the Ten Descents, brings another verse, brings a verse from the Song of, just like Bati Legani, I've come into my garden, is a verse from the Song of Songs. It brings another verse from the Song of Songs. Dodi Yarad Elgano Larugot HaBosem. My beloved, in the Song of Songs, God is the beloved, and we are the kala, the bride. And it says, the bride says, my beloved has descended into his garden. So the word yirida yarad is explicit in that verse. Dodi yarad gano. So this is the first. Once more, this is the first time that Hashem descends into the world. The sixth time is this week's parasha, Vayered Hashem al Har Sinai. So even though there's something unique about this sixth time, because the Chazal say in the Midrash that we said before, that this sixth time of God descending on Mount Sinai is the ultimate nullification of the decree that the higher world should not descend and the lower world should not descend. But in relation to the ten descents, it's actually number six. So now let's go through. We don't have time now to do it in length. This is much more. The whole of Pirkei Rebbe Eliezer, the whole volume is dedicated to explaining these ten descents. Now, these ten descents, even though each one is a one-time descent, but their ramifications or their vibes, the vibrations of these descents continuously. Every time we do something wrong, God descends to see what we did. God descends to great to see what his man, what his created human being did. And he descends to even talk with us and to ask us, what did you do? Where are you, Ayeka? And he descends to give the Torah. Apparently, if we sinned, we didn't have the Torah. So he descends to give us the Torah anew. And all of the ten descents, and this is a tremendous meditation, that all these ten descents are actually things that happen all the time. And all of the infinite God is coming down into our reality to relate to us and to help us ascend. Every descent is for the sake of ascent. The first three of the ten descents are all in a most negative context of sin. The second is, it says, Hashem descended to see the city that man, his created human being, built, and the tower in the middle of the city. When is that? That's called the Dora HaPalaga. It's Migdal Babel, the Tower of Babel. That's the first time is Bati Degani, is the Ma'amar of Yud-Shvat, that God descends into the world. And the second time is he descends, now another very important thing, most of the descent is either to see, it says in the Torah, he descends to see what happened, or he descends to say something. The verb which is used after descending is either to see or to speak. The root of which is ra'ah or diber, which are actually the initial letters of raid, which are the two basic letters of descent. Once more, descending in the Torah is to see and to speak. Ra'ah v'diber. Those two verbs equal the same exactly. Each one equals 206. Ra'ah, diber, Rashi Tevot read. So once more, the first time a God descends into the world is the Garden of Eden. The second time is the Tower of Babel. The third time is storm. Erdana, before God destroys the city of stone, he says to Abraham, that Abraham was afterwards began to argue with him. Hashofet kol ha'aretz lo yaseh mishpat. But first it says, Erdana ve'reah ha'ketzak ha'ta ba'ilai. There was a guru, a little guru in stone that they tortured to death. And God says that I'm going to descend. I mean, the Torah says, God is speaking, Erdana, I will descend. I will see if that cry of that little girl is true, then I'm going to destroy the city of stone. And that's what happened. So that's the third time that God descends into the world. The first three times are all terrible sins, the primordial sin. He descends, and then the Tower of Babel, and then the city of stone, and especially this hakita kata, the cry, the outcry of this tortured guru that wanted to give staka chas v'shalom to someone in that city of stone. What is the next descent? We have to understand all of the descents and give them some model. As we'll see, the model in Kabbalah is the ten sefirot, but beginning from below up, which is itself meaning that all of the descents are in order of descent, in order of ascent. The order of the descents is itself an ascent. We have ascent here. Now you know what ascent is all about. It's the order of the descents of God into the world is the ultimate ascent. So again, it begins the descent into the Garden of Eden is Malchut, and the descent to the Tower of Babel is a symbol of Yesod in Kabbalah. And this girl, that the outcry of this girl that was tortured, that's Behod, that's Hod. And the next one is already begins to be better things, good things. The fourth descent is God says to Yaakov before he goes down to Egypt. Eredim Cham Yisrael, I will descend with you to Egypt. V'alcha gam alo, here is the first time that it is explicitly connects descent to ascent. I will descend with you to Egypt and I will bring you up. And the ascent is actually written in a double phrase. Al chagam alo, ascend, I shall ascend you. But I will first descend myself, I will go down with you into Egypt, and I will take you up. Al chagam alo, that's number four, that's already Netzach. The next one, the fifth descent, is Basne. The first vision that Moshe Rabbeinu had, that God makes him a messenger, appoints him to be the messenger to take us out of Egypt, is at the burning bush. This is the most explicit, because most of these ten descents have a whole chapter about them in Pirkei Dereb Eliezer. And the topic of the chapter of the fifth descent is that God chooses to descend into this burning, to this bush, which is all thorns, in order to identify with the hardship and the suffering of the people in Egypt. Imo anochi b'tzara b'chol tzaratam notzar. I myself descend into the thorns. So what is it? It's an infinite expression of mercy and compassion. So this one fits actually the best of all with the Sfira, that it belongs to Tiferet, which is mercy. God descends into the thorn bush. The whole Shekhinah descends into this bush in order to identify with the suffering and to arouse mercy on the suffering of the bush. That's the fifth time that God descends into the world. The sixth time is our now this week's parsha. Vayered Hashem Haaretz, God descends on Mount Sinai. The next time, and that's the Gvura, why? Because the Torah is Mipi HaGvura, Vayidaber Elokim et kol hadvarim eileh le'emor. Again, we're doing this now, but very, very in short. It said the Torah was given from Gvura, from the mouth of might. The seventh time has been Nikrat Atzur. Nikrat Atzur is the cave that Moses, God says to Moses to hide in the cave, and then my divine presence will pass over you, will pass by, and then God reveals the 13 principles of mercy. Sheinan chozrot reikan, Hashem Hashem kerachum bechanun. And it says, Ve'ered, that God descends. Vayered Hashem ba'anan v'yatzev v'mosham, we say it every day in davening when we say tachin. That God descended in a cloud, and he's and he vayitayatzev imo sham, he stood firmly with Moses there, and he revealed, he spoke the 13 principles of mercy. So even though it's mercy, but in the order of the Sfirot is chesed, kerachum lechanun, it's number 7. The 7th, this every time that we say tachnun every day in davening, so God is descending to us for the 7th time in history. Then there are another 2 descents, the 8th and the 9th descents are both in the Ohel Moed, in the tent, in the tabernacle. The next one is when God descends to take from the spirit of Moses and give it to the 70 elders. And there it says, V'yaradati v'dibarti. This is one of the examples that Yiridah, the descent, goes together with speaking. I will descend and speak with them. And it says once more, V'yarad Hashem ba'anan, that God descended in a cloud. 3 times it says that he descended in a cloud in order to speak and give from the spirit of Moshe to the 70 elders. In Kabbalah it's explicit that the 70 elders are the Sfira of Bina, the next Sfira, Milamata Namal. Then this is both of these, the 8th and the 9th, are one after the other in Parashat Baalotcha. Then it says that Miriam and her brother Aaron spoke against Moses that he separated from his wife. And God descends, says God descends into the tent and calls them and then rebukes them and then tells them, reveals to them the uniqueness of the prophecy of Moses. That uniqueness of the prophecy of Moses, Moshe Rabbeinu, is Chokmah, which is called Zeh HaDavar, it's called Seeing Baspaklaria, Mar'eh V'lo Bechidos, clear prophetic vision that no other prophet has except for Moses. That's the 9th time that God descends into the world. And the final, all of this is in the Pentateuch, in the 5 books of Moses, all of the 9 times. The 10th time we're waiting for. The 10th time is V'amdu Raglav al Har HaZaitim. All of them, the first time, the verse from the Torah is Mitalech, not Yerad. Just that the Midrash says that it's also mentioned in the Song of Songs, Dodi Yerad Degano, that my beloved has come down, descended into his garden. All the others use explicitly the word descend, yarad. Just the last time, it's not, no longer yarad, it's v'amdu. It's from the word that his feet stand on the Mount of Olives. It's Chazal say this is the final descent. It's more the descent of Melchemet Gog u'Magog and Tchiyat HaMetim. That's Keter. In the terminology of Kabbalah and Chassidut, the Zayit is called Mochastima, the Harazitim is Gugalta, which is about the Al Harazitim is Radla, called the 3 heads of the crown, the Sapurna crown. And its feet are the feet of Ak, Vamdu Raglav, Al Har Hazitim. Once more, the Al is faith. And the Har is the Tanug of the Gugalta, and the Zaitim, the Zayit, that we now that we ate before, we can have another one. The Zayit is the hidden brain of the Keter, of the will.
That's something else.
No, because she looked at the Yurida in the Polish. That we said before, that God is continuously here with us. But there's some special meaning to that God now said, I'm going to descend. What does it mean to descend? Descend means that he himself has a descent. I'm going to fall. Before we said that when the B'nai Romi, what motivates God to nullify the decree of B'nai Romi? In English you say, because he fell in love. He fell in love with a girl from Syria. To descend means to fall. God falls. He experiences it. When man falls, God also falls. And sometimes not just because man falls, but because something has to now, some totally new thing has to happen in this world that God created for his glory, for his honor. He has to descend. So it's not just revealing himself. And this is perhaps, again, since this medrash is Pnimiyut HaTorah, the first initial medrash is Pirkei Torah, since this is the topic, so we can say that this concept of God descending is the deepest concept in the Torah. God falling for us. When we fall, it begins from the three first ones, or when we fall, God falls for us. But he falls to see, and he also falls to punish. It's all part of the story. The punishment is a rectification. But again, the ultimate one of all of them is the giving of the Torah. Also, is God falling for us? Is descending on Har Sinai? Actually, it's all this coming down on Har Sinai goes back to the first one. It's coming to Bati Ligani. Coming to the God. It also has to do with the last one, because the last one is also a mountain. It's Har HaZaitim. So there's Har Sinai, and at the end there's Har HaZaitim, V'amdu Raglava Har HaZaitim. And the first one is entering, is falling into the garden. Right, so there's a lot to think about. But this was because of Parashat Yitro, which is Vayered Hashem Har Sinai, Pre-Tzadik, go back to Pre-Tzadik, the second letters are Reish Dalet, Pre-Tzadik, Pre-Tzadik Esh Chayim, which is called the Shar, it's the two-letter root of the word Yarad, to descend. In the Pre-Tzadik there's also alluded to a descent. Descent to see and to speak. L'chaim, l'chaim. You got that?
That's a positive. Okay. L'chaim, l'chaim.
Getting ready for the last descent, right?
Again. How many times? Are we done? Yeah.
When a man falls in love with a woman, he falls in love to see and to punish? How does it work?
To see and talk. To see him and talk with her. What is Shlomo's favorite nigun?
Which was his favorite
nigun?
I have it on my phone. Oh,
yeah. Oh, hey, nato, ato ke mistate, oh, hey. Yeridaya, Mamma, Maya, Yeridaya. Hi, Yeridaya, Bam, 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 Bam. Oh, hey, Nato, Ato, Kelmista, there. Oh, hey, Nato, Ato, Kelmista, there. Oh, yeah, Yeridaya, Bam, Bam, Maya, Yeridaya. Ya ya yire dai yam bam 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 ho kheina to ato kel mistate ho kheina to ato kel mistate ya ya yire dai yam bam 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 yire dai ya ya yire dai yam bam 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 O cheina to, ato kemistater. O cheina to, ato kemistater. Ay, 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 yiridai, yam, bam, 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 yiridai. Am, ay, ay, yiridai, yam, bam, 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 bam. O cheina to, ato kemistater. O cheina to, ato kemistater. Ay, 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 yiridam, bam, 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 yiridam. Bam, bam, ay, yiridam, bam, 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 bam.
Before we talked about